wouldn't you agree? I think you would agree, each and every one of us, that there's a weird value system in the world today. Would you agree with that? You know, you go like, what is it that people value? And you read about things and you see things. And then sometimes you just kind of step back and shake your head. And we are confronted with this each and every day. Think about the things that you may have heard about this week that people value. And sometimes, and many times, what they value is just like it's instantly gone, isn't it? And what happens if you place your life on that particular value and now that's gone? What happens? What takes place in all life? But just think through some of the things maybe that people have assigned value. Now, every now and then, I like to watch that show. It's called, what, Antiques? What is it? Yeah, that's it, Antiques Roadshow. And people will bring things in that they valued. And sometimes, they found it in an attic or something, and they found it in the wall of their home. And so I wanted to go tear the walls off my house, you know, to find out something that's in there. And sometimes they are things of high value, and sometimes they're just junk, right? Hey, good for you. You found something worth $5, you know, like that. And value is assigned. But listen to some. How about this? I got some things that people value, and they seem kind of weird to me. Okay, the first one here. Go look, mason jars. You got mason jars in your home? Okay. Well, you're going to be happy about this because some are said to be worth, guess what, $1,000. So go check out your mason jars when you go home. See how that works out for you. Okay, I got a second one, lunch boxes. I'm going to ask you, how much value do you think there is in some of the lunch boxes? I'm not going to put it up yet. Like, if you have a Spider-Man lunch box or a Superman lunch box, right? First of all, you're probably not going to admit it, right? I got a lunch box, you know. Okay. Anyway, but some of them, guess what? Will fetch, what would you guess? Thousands, right? Yeah, how about this one right here? Up to $16,000. So go home, check out your lunch boxes. How about postcards? There are collectors of postcards, right? And so a postcard can be worth hundreds or even thousands of dollars. Then this one seems weird to me. Maybe because I'm not into it. Perfume bottles. Do you know that some perfume bottles are worth up to $1,000? I mean, I go like, if you're going to value something, find something other than a perfume bottle, for crying out loud, okay? All right, are you ready? Last one. Okay, VHS tapes. Some of you still have them, don't you? And you still have those 8-track or VHS tapes players, don't you? Right? Well, there are some VHS tapes, you know, that are worth up to $750, you know, because like Disney's 101 Dalmatians, which I have never watched, but maybe you have, they're worth this. But let me ask you a question. Have you ever thought this? Here it is right here. The question is like, who determines the value of this stuff? Who said a mason jar is worth $1,000? Perfume bottle? Who values this? Who says like, this is how much this is worth? I'd like for you to think about that this morning. Because quite honestly, whether you're online or you're home or you're here in person, and all day today, I think I'll be talking to some people who are stuck here. Because when we talk about the value of a mason jar or the value of a lunchbox, we have people going like, well, who values me? Because somebody has convinced you of your value. And for some of us, maybe it's high. For some of us, maybe not so. And I ask the question like, well, who places a value on stuff? Who places the value on you? Who places the value on life? See, we sometimes try to create self-value because someone determined what you're worth. And our next gathering, we'll be talking to a lot of students today. And this is an area that I think that we've all struggled, and maybe it starts in our teen years or even before, because somebody valued us, and therefore we have high self-esteem or low self-esteem, all depending upon the value that was placed on us. And so we try to create self-value sometimes because people determine that the person that looks this way or a person that looks this way is worth more in life. Listen to this. According to the Baylor College of Medicine, nearly $16.7 billion was spent on cosmetic procedures in the U.S. in 2020. $16 billion. And while some of this was for a good reason and a need, I would venture to guess that most of it was used to respond to a value system that somebody said, you're worth more if you don't have that, or you're worth more if you get that. You're worth more if you have less wrinkles. And I used to joke with my wife, I'm just going to go in for just a little bit of a kind of a nip and tuck and get rid of these wrinkles that are starting to form, you know, because like, who wants to have a wrinkle? Who is it that said you're worth more if you look this way, or you're worth more if that is not part of your life? And it's driving people to respond to a value system. Interestingly, Baylor answers why cosmetic surgery remained so popular during the pandemic. Listen to this. This is a quote. More people were using video technology. You know what happens with video technology? You look at yourself and you go, oh, dear Lord, what happened? So video tech, and they became more aware of what they look like in a public setting. So, you know, our team here is a hybrid team, so we're remote and also in person and in office, and we're always like, can you, who place that value on a person? Like, you got to look this way in the video, so you got the right lighting, and you got to have something fixed so you look good. And so I'm going to ask you the question again, who determined your value? Interesting interaction that Jesus had one day. In John chapter 4, we read about it. I'll just read part of it, and I just want to summarize it. It's a woman of Samaria. Now, when Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus was making and baptizing more disciples than John, although Jesus himself did not baptize, but only his disciples, he left Judea, that is Jesus, and departed again for Galilee. And he had to pass through Samaria. Now, we're not going to stop there, but that's an interesting phrase. He had to pass through Samaria. So he came to the town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. And a woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, give me a drink. For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, how is it that you, a Jew, ask me for a drink, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. And all of a sudden we see a value system placed on this woman by others. Jesus has this conversation in a place that he did not have to go. The woman was despised because she was a Samaritan, an outcast, and looked down upon by her own people. How do we know? Well, if you read into the text and you understand the context and the culture, she was alone when she came to draw water. Alone during a time of day that normally would have been a social gathering. It's like when you and I, like, hey, let's go grab a cup of coffee, right? Let's go do this. It was a social gathering. And she was alone. It was a social high point, but she was by herself. She was ostracized and marked as immoral due to her list of husbands. And so if you were assigning value and the value that was assigned that day, or she was assigning value to herself, it would have probably come way less than a lunchbox or a mason jar. But here is Jesus. This is the one that Jesus sought out and offered a brand new life. And it shouldn't be lost on us that Jesus, God, actively sought you and me out. And maybe you're in that place where you didn't feel like you had much value, But listen to this, Jesus sought you out and he sought me out. That's the value he placed on you and on me. Next time you go to a mirror, and we heard about that, you know, amongst our students, snow blast. Next time you go to the mirror, look at yourself as a value that God has placed, the value that God has placed on you, enough to die for you. And so here's a lesson that we learn. All people are valuable to God at every age and stage, and we are to value people at every age and stage. And that's what we're talking about today as we wrap up this series called DNA. How do we live out this Jesus DNA? And we've talked a number of areas. This is part number 9. So if you need to get caught up, I just encourage you to go back to our website, gatewayfellowship.com, and you can get caught up. But today we're talking about people of life, people who value people. All people are valuable to God at every age and stage, and we are to value people at every age and stage. See, critical to our teaching today, and maybe as a corollary to that thought, is that how you value others begins how you value yourself, and how you value yourself begins with how God values you. Are you with me on that? See, how we look at others and how we value others begins with how you value yourself, how you see yourself through God's lens, and how you value yourself begins with how God sees you, how God values you. All are created in the image of God, and God values life from womb to tomb because he is the creator of life and the one who sustains all of life and the redeemer of all human beings. So today, we're talking about being people of life. As we live out our Jesus DNA, we are to be people who value all of life, beginning with the beginning, the middle, and the end. So I'm going to talk about this in 3 different areas, and we're going to talk about life at the beginning. Number 1, God values life in the womb because he is the creator of life. That's the beginning. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you, and before you were born, I consecrated you. Psalm 139, verses 13 to 16, for you formed my inward parts, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, my soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in a secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there were none of them. From beginning to end, David speaks of himself as the very creation of God, as a distinct person. You see, the creator, the one who values all of life, formed every part of life. Referring to the incarnation of Christ, Matthew chapter 1:18, this is how Jesus, the Messiah, was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Dr. John Jefferson Davis, in Evangelical Ethics Issues Facing the Church, he writes this. He says, in the New Testament, the incarnation of Jesus Christ is a profound testimony to God's affirmation and of the sanctity of prenatal life. His human history, like ours, began at conception. The significant point is that God chose to begin the process of incarnation there rather than at some other point, thus affirming the significance of that starting point for human life. Now remember, we're talking about the value of life at every age and stage. This is the beginning of life. Wayne Grudem, quoting Diane Irvine, who is a biochemist and biologist at Georgetown University, says this, alongside the biblical testimony about the personhood of the unborn child, scientific evidence also indicates that each child in the womb should be considered a unique human person. Irvine, to begin with, scientifically, something very radical occurs between the process of gametogenesis and fertilization. The change from a simple part of one human being, the sperm, and a simple part of another human being, the egg, which simply possesses human life, to a new genetically unique, newly existing individual, whole living human being, that is, upon fertilization, parts of human beings have been transformed into something very different from what they were before. They have been changed into a single, whole human being. During the process of fertilization, the sperm and the egg cease to exist as such, and a new human being is produced. This is the beginning of life. We're to value all of life. And by the way, we call this a baby. Baby. So we value the image of God in every human being from the moment of conception, believing that every person has a purpose and a right to life. Because life begins at conception, and God values every human life. Followers of Jesus who live out our Jesus DNA value life. Now, parenthetically here, let me say this. Let us never be the ones who condemn those who made a decision that they would not make today, but rather offer the grace and forgiveness all of us needed and receive from our loving God. Good place to say amen. We have developed a brand new partnership with a local business in town called Peaks. Have you seen it? It's up here on the street. They do 3D, 4D imaging. And so I've met with them. We know that when people view life in the womb, it's more likely that they will make a decision to keep that baby that's in the womb. And so I spent some of your money. And we gave them $1,000 to provide scholarships for women who might not be able to cover the cost of that imaging. Some other things that we're doing, and you're gonna meet them in a weeks ahead. So we're all in on this. We're all in. We value life. But it doesn't end there, because we are a pro-life church, not a pro-birth church. And in case you're not sure exactly what that means, is that we're not just pro-birth, we're pro-life. We need to take care of everybody. We value all of life. We understand as people of life, God values children in the womb. He values children. God values children because they are a blessing and a heritage from the Lord. Remember, we're talking about all of life, the beginning, the middle, and the end today, as people who value life, living out our Jesus DNA. Now, today, perhaps, I might be talking to some parents, and you had a struggle with your kids coming to church today, and so you're going to go like, I'm not sure I'm on board with that thought right now at this moment, but I know that you are. God values children because they are a blessing and they are a heritage from the Lord. Psalm 127. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb, a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior are the children of one's youth. Blessed is a man who fills his quiver with them. Now, I'm not telling you how many that looks like. I mean, some of you have a fuller quiver than others. Now, I'm not suggesting what that looks like, but children are a blessing from the Lord. And we are to value children. Luke chapter 18, verses 15 through 17. Now they are bringing even infants to him that he might touch them. And when the disciples saw it, they rebuked them. But Jesus called to them, saying, let the children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God. Truly I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a child shall not enter it. And so the question that I have written down here for us to think about is, how do we live this out as a faith community? How do we value the beginning of life? How do we value children? Well, following the example of Jesus, we say, come on in to children. You have a place here, no matter your age or your stage. Don't hinder them by making church a place that they have to go. Make it a place that they want to go. That's why I love our children's ministries. That's why I love our lobby full of children. That's why I love children in this setting here. Now, I love to hear the noise of kids. I love it when they wander down front. Maybe it bothers you. It doesn't bother me. We need to make this a place that children are welcome and feel welcome. But they're running through the church. So what? Why don't you run with them? Try that out. They ate crackers. They got crumbs on the carpet. So what? We clean it up. They broke a chair. So what? Would you rather have them out there somewhere? Or would you rather have them here? And I say, we say here. Let's help our parents by valuing the life of every child who comes through our doors and sits in our seats by creating the space for them to be loved and cared for. People who say, come on, we value you. Every age and every stage. And we will be people who pray for our parents, because some of us who have kids who are gone now are at a different age and stage. But we commit to praying for each and every one of our parents and valuing their children. It doesn't matter if you can remember their names or not. It doesn't matter when you see them running to the lobby or here, or you hear them. It's just a great moment to stop and pray for the parent of that child. Let's be people who pray for our parents. Let's pray for single parents who are going it alone. And I include our military families that we can support when their spouses are away. Let's support our parents as they live out this biblical command in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 through 7. And these words I command to you today, that they shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. Let's be people who say to our families, this is your place, and we will support you regardless of what it is that you're facing. We will support you regardless of our age and stage. We will pray for you, and we will pray for your sons and for your daughters. We can't talk about children without talking about those who have not been valued or cared for as they should. There are foster kids. We can't talk about children and the value that God places on all of life and not come alongside the parents who care and nurture and love foster kids. And they are people in our church. As people living out our Jesus DNA, people of life, we will step into that place and support our foster kids and foster parents in a way that honors Jesus. Psalm 68 says this, that God places the lonely in families, and that's happening everywhere. This includes not only our foster families, but also a church family, our church family, as an extension and support of each foster home. This is why we launched the Family Matters Ministry that you've heard about. And in the lobby today, you're going to see people at a booth called Family Matters. It's one way that we're supporting our foster families, wrapping around them, helping them out. This is why we partner with Olive Crest and provide camp for kids called Royal Family Kids. This is why we continue to bring you before you opportunities to support these people as people who value life, that we will do this thing together. Royal Family Kids Camp has been existing. Gosh, Brent's coming right now. And Brent, our director, would you welcome Brent today? Just one of the things that we're doing. And I think, Brent, we're celebrating 30 years or 31 years or something like that now of Royal Family Kids, right?
Yep, this is year 32.
Year of 32. And when we began it 32 years ago, I'm not sure anyone thought that we would be going for this many years. But when we talk about valuing our children and our foster kids and those who have not had a fair shake in life, Royal Family Kids is stepping into that gap and helping.
Right. Even if it's just for 1 week of an overnight camp for the kids, it tends to be life-changing for them, life-changing for the adults. Do you mind if I?
Please go ahead.
I read a little bit.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is my 13th year with Royal Family Kids Camp. Didn't discover it until we started attending Gateway Fellowship. So thanks and kudos to Gateway CMC. In 1992, okay, the idea came to this congregation, and John and Jude stepped forward and carried it for 21 years. Then they passed it off, and this is my 11th year as the director. our whole goal, like Tom's been talking about it, it was the perfect segue, and he brought the emotion, and he brought you the tears, so I didn't have to do that this morning, right? But our whole goal is to get kids in foster care. The specific goal is children in foster care. Why? Because they don't belong anywhere. They have the feeling they don't belong anywhere, and we want to change that, even if it's just for 1 week. But it's 1 week in the great outdoors with loving people from our church, from area churches, and for 120 hours, okay, we just give our lives to the kids who haven't had much of a life. And their value is probably not very good, right? Their value is not high. They've not been valued, or the value they have for their life is the value of the price tag that comes along with every person in the state system who has to see them on a daily basis. That's what they think their value is, what the people who are in their lives are getting paid. And that's another great thing about camp, is that there's not a single person who's getting paid on the team of Royal Family Kids Camp. Okay, it's out of our hearts. It's out of the calling that God has given us to jump into this ministry. And there's so many people here who have given in so many different ways. So for myself today, I just want to invite you guys to maybe think about it. Think about how you can help this year. There's just a couple pictures up there of some fun things we do at camp. And then we'll go to the next slide, which kind of gives a few areas of what we're trying to accomplish this year. Okay, so our top priority is, and it always is, we need people to be praying for camp. And you can do that on your own. But if you want to sign up to be on a prayer list, we'll contact you the week before camp and provide the campers' names and all of the volunteers' names. So you can put an actual name to all the people that are going to be out at camp. And financially, this might be the first year for me, being the director, that I'm asking for money. I'm making it part of my campaign this year to ask for money. And the reason is simple. Everything costs more. It's been really hard for camps. Camps are closing all over the country. And so the camp we attend has almost doubled our weekly invoice from 2020. And it's very, very pricey. So we are asking for a financial need. And I believe you can go onto the PushPay app.
Exactly. And so if you go to more, and we'll have that number later, and I just brought it up, number 6 is Royal Family Kids, and you can know more how to be involved in that.
Perfect. Yeah. So yeah, so that's an option. And then a couple of specific needs. Okay, we have a rule. Okay, each counselor only is allowed to have 2 campers, and that's for safety. But as you can imagine, you can't be with your campers like every second of every day, because you have to use the restroom, you have to do things, take care of yourself. So we need people who will come along and be support staff, who can do the training, come to camp, stay the week with us, and step in when the counselor needs to step aside to get that cup of coffee to keep him going, right? Or to step in so that the counselor can stay with his other camper or her other camper and get the Bible story because the other camper needs to go to the restroom. So those support staff come in really handy to help take those campers who just need a little bit of a distraction for a few minutes. And of course, we can't take kids unless we have counselors. So if you're 18 or over, and that's what we need for counselors, there are other opportunities for kids ages 16 and 17, but to be a counselor, you have to be 18 or older. And then you would be assigned 2 campers for the whole week, and we have one goal. That's to show the love of Jesus, to show them that they belong and that they're valued the way Jesus values them. So I'll be in the lobby, and I have a few handouts if people just want to take a look at it, or if you want to fill it out and leave with me. You're not signing up today and promising me you'll come. It's just a conversation to get you in the door and just to kind of get us start talking. So thank you guys very much. Thanks, Tom.
I have been to Royal Family Kids Camp many, many, many years, many, many times, and to see what's taking place there is exactly what we're talking about this morning. And we have had kids who have attended camp who have come to faith in Jesus, are serving Jesus today because this week at camp. We have had foster kids adopted into homes because of this week of camp. So would you pray about that? would you consider stopping by Brent's table in the back and talking to him how you can be involved, from praying to financial supporting to maybe even being a part of the team. We value the beginning of life. We value our children, and we value those who have not had a fair shake at life, our foster kids. We will be a church that values those that Jesus values. But finally this morning, we value the elderly living in their wisdom years. Remember I said we're going to talk about the value of life in the beginning, the middle, and the end. And unfortunately, there is a value system out there that I think you can come across that says, like, when you get older, you kind of lose your value in life. And I reject that. And it's not because I'm at a certain age. It's because I think it's biblically, the Bible values all of life. And those in their wisdom years, listen to Proverbs chapter 23, verse 22, or listen to your father who gave you life, and do not despise your mother when she is old. I am thankful for those who are living in their wisdom years at Gateway. I hope you are as well. I'm thankful for those who have sacrificed, have given so much, and who continue to give. They might not be able to go and do camp like we talked about. They might not be able to do everything, but these are people who continue to pray, continue to support all that's going on here. They are people living in their wisdom years. 1 Peter chapter 5 says, in the same way, you who are younger, be submissive to those who are older. Now, what we're talking about is respecting those who are in their wisdom years. All of you, clothe yourselves with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. I would suggest to you that each and every one of us ought to find someone older than us, and just say thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for what you have. You're living in your wisdom years, and we need everyone to be a part. Everyone is a person of value. Let me wrap it up this way, and then we're going to pray and we're going to join in communion together. We value all of life from womb to tomb. We value the image of God in every human being. We value the sovereignty of God, who alone determines the beginning and the end of life. Three next steps. Number one, pray for our families and their kids. Will you do that? Maybe you'll make a brand new commitment today to be that person who prays for our families, who prays for the kids that God brings to Gateway of all ages, our younger students and our teens who would be gathering here at 10:30. Consider joining Family Matters, supporting our foster families and Royal Family Kids Camp. Both will be in the lobby today. You can ask how to be a part of that, and consider Life Matters support, financial support. We're going to continue spending your money in ways I just described earlier today. In all of these, you can go to this number, 360-505-4636, and you'll find all of them there. That number will come up in just a moment, 360-505-4636. And all you need to do is, when that comes back to you, you just type in the number and hit send, and you'll discover brand new ways, perhaps, that you can step in to supporting life at every stage, the beginning, the middle, and the end. Aren't you thankful that God said to you, I love you so much that I'm going to die for you? Are you thankful for that? I am. And now we get to live that life out as followers of Jesus. We get to see the image of God in each and every person. We get to celebrate the life that only Jesus can bring. So consider texting into that number. We're going to gather around the communion table this morning, and we're going to extend our thanks to God by thanking him for the life that he has given us and for the promise of eternity. When this life ends, this physical life ends, followers of Jesus are with him for eternity. And I don't know about you, I'm looking forward to that day, whenever it comes. I think you are as well. Most of us have friends and family who have gone on before us. And Jesus says, not to worry. There's a day coming when you all be reunited. And that's going to be a great day, isn't it? Some of us are in need this morning. And so we're going to take the bread, and we're going to pray, and we're going to give the Lord thanks for his broken body that provides healing for every part of our life, spiritual healing, physical healing, financial healing, whatever it is. He provides all that we need. So if you're in that place, we're going to pray. Then we're going to take and pray over the cup and give him thanks for his shed blood on Calvary that allows us to stand in right relationship with the Father. So, Lord, we thank you today for the opportunity we have to come into this place and just speak of your love and to reflect on your deep, deep love for us. You've done so much. Remind us today of the value that you placed on each and every one of our lives. And may we live that out, Lord, each and every day, at every age and every stage. Thank you for your broken body that was broken, that we might be made whole in every way. So as we take the bread, we receive from you. As we take of the cup, we give thanks for the sacrifice that you made on our behalf. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take the bread together and receive, shall we? And then the cup together, let's take it and give thanks. Amen. Amen. Lord, we give you thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together, shall we?
I hear the Savior say, thy strength in need is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He was it white as snow. He was it white as snow.
He washed.
He was it white as snow.